Welcome everybody to the WebGL Meetup hosted by the Khronos Group and also one of our long-standing sponsors. I'm Tony Parisi, co-organizer. Damon Hernandez, you in the house somewhere? I saw you. Stand up, wave. My co-organizer Damon back there. We run the San Francisco WebGL Meetup Group. We're over 900 members. We're about 4 years old, dedicated to WebGL development topics. Sometimes we talk specs, sometimes we talk tools, sometimes we look at applications. Always we drink. usually we have pizza. Thankfully tonight we're taking a break from that. I'm a little pizzaed out. Three meetups a week, pizza adds up. It's all right in there. Anyway, thanks to Khronos, who's always our sponsors. Thank you very much. Leap Motion is an often sponsor of us. They're demoing in the back there, and one of the speakers will be from Leap today, Peter Ehrlich, and he's going to talk WebGL and Leap, but you also can see WebVR, virtual reality, and Leap Motion back there at the demo stations. All right, we got kind of a packed agenda tonight. Each speaker is going to go about 10 to 15 minutes, and we're going to try and get done with the talks by, say, 6:30. So we have more time to drink more beer. And it goes a little bit like this. We're going to start off with an update from the WebGL working group. These are the people who bring us the spec. They, behind the scenes, make the sausage, which tastes so good when it's ready. And it's really good. WebGL is really good. It runs everywhere. It runs on your iPad. It runs on your phone. It powers virtual reality. It runs in watches. It does all these crazy things now. It slices, dices, and makes julienne fries. And the people here who've brought you the spec and some of the implementations are going to talk to you with about an update. And we have Brandon Jones from Google, Jeff Gilbert from Mozilla, Ken and Mo from the Chrome team, and Jamie as well. So take it away, guys. Who starts?
Is there anyone else from the Chrome team here?
If you want to
come up, and Janusz, would you join us? So, hello everybody, thanks for coming. So my name's Ken, I'm the chair of the WebGL Working Group. I'd like everybody to introduce their own selves. We bring you the sausage.
Thanks guys.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ken. So I'm Brandon Jones. I work on the Google Chrome WebGL implementation and also WebVR, if you want to ping me about that afterwards.
I'm Jeff Gilbert. I work on the Mozilla implementation of WebGL.
And I'm Zhenyao Mo. I'm working on Chrome WebGL implementation.
Hi.
I'm Jamie Medill. I work on Chrome's WebGL implementation primarily on Angle.
Hi, I'm Janusz Sobczak. I'm working on the WebGL conformance suite.
Hi, I'm Vince Scheib. I work on Chrome on the platform features such as pointer lock.
Hey, Jeff, do you want to come up?
We have another angle
We have another member of the angle team here.
I'm outnumbered.
Yes.
I'm Jeff. I work mostly on angle with Jamie here.
So in the form of an update, let's just talk about WebGL 2. Everybody knows that we have to update the platform to take advantage of the features that are already in your mobile phones, and everybody up here is basically a part of that effort. There's been a lot of work on the specification over the past year, over the past 6 months in particular. There's been a lot of work on implementations. Mozilla has some very nice demos in their booth, and you probably saw press releases yesterday about this. Do you want to talk a little bit more about the partnerships there?
Yeah, sure. I think the biggest demo WebGL 2 related was we worked with Unity to get a up and running as exporter from Unity port of their teleporter demo into Firefox, a prototype version of Firefox with WebGL 2. So that's up and running at our GDC booth if you want to see that, and I'll also be able to show that to people here after this. So that's probably the most exciting thing. We also have a number of other things at the booth, but the WebGL 2 thing was as exported from Unity, WebGL 2 running in a prototype, but today, that you can see.
Yes, so I mean, it's been just a really good effort across browsers, across operating systems, and across teams. So may I point out that Brandon and Mo have been working on the entire API stack for ES 3.0 and WebGL 2 in Chrome. Jeff has been, you know, leading the effort, the same effort on the Mozilla side. Jamie and Jeff have been working on OpenGL ES 3 on Windows and making it work well on top of Direct3D 11, which is a necessity at this point. And I wanted to introduce Janusz from Mobica because Mobica has been bringing a very powerful test suite, the Draw Elements OpenGL ES 3 conformance subset, to WebGL. This is what is going to make sure that WebGL 2 behaves the same across every browser and across every operating system. And so we're glad to be working with you guys and looking forward to a successful delivery of that conformance suite and implementations that pass it.
I'll make sure that.
Yeah, good.
So unfortunately, this is a little washed out on the projector, but hopefully you guys can see it. And hopefully everyone can hear me, right? All right, cool. So this is kind of the current state of the art with Chrome right now. This is not in any build that you can download at the moment. We're still working on getting all of the bug fixes in to make this work in Chrome top of tree. But it should be hopefully very soon. The big outstanding thing that we're working on right now is getting the basics working in Mac. But what we want to do is get the WebGL 2 implementation to the point where you can actually launch it in Chrome Canary behind a flag, and it will be horrifically unsafe. If you do something bad, it will crash on you. You know, you'll get all sorts of errors. We're not going to do much type checking for you initially or anything like that, but it will get you to a point where you can begin to experiment with the API and give us feedback and let us know when it crashes horrifically on you so that we can fix it going forward. And we want people to be able to give us feedback as early in the process as possible to make sure that this remains robust going forward. So we wanted to give you a quick preview of what's going on here. This is a demo that was actually originally done by Mr. Dube, 3JS fame, where he was running like 2 million particles. This is only 1 million particles, sorry to disappoint. And he was doing it through in WebGL 1, using a series of ping-ponging to render textures to track the position of it, every particle from frame to frame. And this worked, but it was a somewhat inelegant solution that was necessitated by the limitations of WebGL 1. In WebGL 2, we actually have a much more robust feature called transform feedback, which allows us to take the simulation that's running here in a shader and actually feed it back into a vertex buffer directly from that shader. So everything stays on the GPU. You don't have to rebuild a buffer in JavaScript every frame, and it allows you to do a lot of really interesting effects. Now, this effect in and of itself is really interesting, but we really want to drive home how dynamic it could be, and so we've got some leap motion integration in here, and when I swipe my hands through the particles, we get a little bit of gravity going on there. They bounce on the ground, they swirl some more, and I can sit there and tickle it with my finger. It's actually, you know, the collision model here is very simple. It's a bunch of spheres that are hidden in the fingers and the palm of the hand and everything. But it's a very nice effect, and it's extremely fluid. You can see with the frames per second counter, this is running 60 frames per second, or as near as the projector will allow. And it's a very, very nice fluid experience. Now, there's a couple of benefits to going this direction over what we had in WebGL 1. We have noticed definitely that the memory usage for this method versus the texture method is much lower. Well, not much lower, but it is noticeably lower. We've also noticed that on some platforms, the performance can be reasonably better. We were seeing differences of like 18 frames per second to 30 frames per second on one of our lower end GPUs. This is something that varies highly based on the GPU and the operating system, but it's a very useful tool to have in your tool belt, and it's just a hell of a lot of fun. So, this is, once again, not in top of tree Chromium. We are working very hard on it. I want to especially shout out to Mo, who has been working very, very hard on getting the ES3 backend plumbed all the way through. It's really been a heroic effort, and we will notify you all as soon as you can play with this yourself. The source code for this particular example is up on GitHub right now. I'll make sure that it's posted to the Meetup page, And if you have any questions or feedback on it, then let me know. I'll take a couple of questions now, if you don't mind, and then we'll let Jeff show what they've been working on.
Frames per second, will that be, you can get it now in the console, but I see you have a little widget, frames per second widget up there.
Yeah, so
will it be something?
This frames per second widget is actually something that Chrome provides. If you go into About Flags and search for the text FPS, it's actually a checkbox that you can turn on there. I've got it up here just so you can see that we are running 60 frames per second. It's also something you can get from the dev tools, but that hooks pretty deep into our compositing system and gives you, really, really nice precise numbers. Mostly because this particular hardware that I'm running on wasn't quite powerful enough to do that. The 2 million particle version was really aimed at higher end GPUs, and this is a laptop that we stole from our QA department, so it's not quite equipped for that many particles. No, nothing like that. In fact, I think that with the transform feedback, you could actually potentially do more particles because you're not limited by texture dimensions, which is something that was a limitation in the previous version. So if your implementation restricted you to 4K by 4K, then that's the maximum number of particles you could do using this method. That's not the case in WebGL2. It will be. I've been neglecting my duties. So the question was, is it possible to read the buffers like this back into JavaScript? And the answer is yes, we're going to have a method in WebGL2. It's not map buffers, which is what's exposed in ES3. It's actually Git buffer subdata, thank you. And there's some technical reasons why we couldn't expose map buffers directly. It just doesn't play well with the JavaScript memory model. But that will allow you to read back a chunk of a buffer into a JavaScript typed array. Anything else? All right, great. Well, thank you very much. And let's turn the time over to Mozilla.
All right, so I mentioned earlier that we partnered with Unity to port actual WebGL2 content to get some content to really sink our teeth into in terms of getting our prototype up and running. So while this fails to work, succeeds at work. There we go. All right, you get my super exciting desktop. So the demo we ported was Teleporter. And this is a custom version of Firefox, which the code technically it's on GitHub. It's in one of our custom branches that we're using for development for this. So it exists, but it's not really in a shape you can ship. It's even more sharp than our usual it's in Nightly, but it's a pref. Don't touch it. But you will see this coming up in Nightly as soon as we possibly can. What do I have to do? This. There we go. And so this is running WebGL 2. This is, the list of things that you add with WebGL 2 is pretty long. Transform feedback is a big one that Brandon touched on. You get a whole slew of new GLSL features, so you get much more sophisticated shaders. You get 3D textures. You get occlusion queries. You get a whole bunch of things. So this is very darkly showing you what it can actually do. There we go. And so this is the demo that's running at our booth right now. You can see it on better hardware than this, so it's not stuttering. But yeah, this is what we've been working on for the past, especially for the past month or so. Question?
So what part of this is WebGL features?
What part of this is WebGL 2 features?
A bunch of it. In some ways, it's sort of hard to tell you directly. Like, I have to like reverse engineer, because the way that all this stuff works is that you have content like in Unity, and you make it in Unity, and you make it using their nice GUI development suite, and then you click the export to WebGL button, and then magic, and it's in your browser. So like, which parts are specifically WebGL 2, I'm not that confident in. But you can see some stuff going on, like you can see a bag inflating and deflating, that's probably transform feedback. There's particle effects, which are almost certainly transform feedback. I believe there's ambient occlusion. There's definitely occlusion queries going on. There's also sound you can't really hear, which isn't WebGL 2, but I can hear it. And the shading language. I think really the biggest one is the shading language you get. You get a whole bunch of new things. Just like, it's a new language. Like, it's a modern language. More, not like DX12 Mantle Vulkan modern, but like modern, like OpenGL 4-ish, GLES 3. It's the GLES 3 shading language. Good.
What is the size of the compiled M script in?
For this one, I don't. The size of the download.
JavaScript.
Just the JavaScript. I don't know, since I think it's all bundled together. The zip size as I downloaded it was 350 megs, so it's fairly large.
That's probably assets, actually.
A lot of that is assets. Like, traditionally, what we commonly see with Emscripten demos is, since it's really easy, people just drop it in the virtual Emscripten file system. And that just shoves it all into basically a big ASM heap. And so you get all of the assets are now just in there. So I can't really tell you how much of that is just JavaScript. I think it's on the order of like 80 to 100 megs, but I don't actually know.
Would this work on mobile?
Would this work on mobile? Yes. it's the same answer. Like, does it work on Linux? Does it work on Mac? Is yes. Working, like, that's the promise we're making, right? We're promising that this stuff is all going to work on Mac. And indeed, if you have an Android device in your pocket that is running Lollipop, the newest version of the Android OS, it has OpenGL ES3. So it technologically is capable of running this. Are you going to see the same frame rates? Would probably surprise you.
Well, the question is really, is it capable of running 100 meg of JavaScript more than
Yeah, I think so. Is it possible to run the same like 100 to 300 megabyte JavaScript chunk? Yes. The problem there is in terms of like feasibility of like distribution, right? It's one of the common problems we have. Like, if you have an app that you're installing, it's sort of fine. You have a large original download, it doesn't matter that much. If it's a website you're just going to, you're going to sit through a long loading screen. So we're actively looking for solutions for that. Anyone else?
Frame rate
for this? Depends on your hardware. It's definitely running, I'm pretty sure it's actually running near 60 frames per second here. Might be lower because it's doing weird mirroring stuff. Definitely at like on the slightly beefier hardware, it's running 60 frames a second, and not really breaking a sweat. Like, CPU usage is not high, and GPU usage doesn't seem high either. Like, I don't think we're near the limits. This is just a good tech demo to show like what some of the new pretty stuff we can give you, put in your hands. Anyone else? Cool. Okay. Oh yeah, Unity 5 is released, so it has support for exporting to WebGL. WebGL 1, not WebGL 2 yet, because WebGL 2 doesn't exist as such yet. We're working on that, and we hope to put like the super dangerous pref in your hand as soon as possible, so you guys can like rip it open and see what works and what doesn't, and give us feedback on that, and just make really cool stuff, and then ship it. When can we expect this? Like, what's an ETA? Is a good phrasing of that.
Is it a year? Is it 2 years?
I would say, you might be able to answer that better, Ken, but I want to put the super dangerous pref at Q2, I think.
Yeah. From Chrome's standpoint, we want to get that the command line flag that turns on the WebGL 2 prototype ASAP. The way that WebGL 1 came out, as you may remember, was experimental WebGL, and the implementation evolved as you, the developers, you know, brought out awesome content on top of it, and that worked really well. I don't think it works so well to have something that just lands as a big pile and it's like, all right, here you go. You should actually see it evolve over time. So we're, you know, Firefox already has the pref, but, you know, it doesn't enable all
the stuff. Have everything.
Right.
Not everything's landed yet.
Same thing in Chrome. We rushed to get stuff done for GDC. We didn't quite make it, sorry. But I think it's less important to make this one deadline, and it's more important to just get it out there and then have a nice gradual evolution. So the dangerous pref ASAP, I would say in 6 months' time, we want to see a really solid conformance suite and implementations almost passing it. So I would say, you know, 6 months' time, we're going to be really close to shipping WebGL 2. We're not going to call the spec done until we have two implementations that are passing the conformance tests, but we're getting there at ASAP.
So in other words, before the Oculus commercial version release of the consumer product, how about that? So just a reminder to everybody, that's a web browser. That's why we have this meetup group. Oh, right. Thank you, Jeff and Brandon, for the awesome demos. And we're ready for our next speaker. So we talk a lot about 3D rendering in this meetup group, but when we think about 3D data, and if we could think about one company whose tools are used to create 3D data, what would that company be? Autodesk. Our next speaker is from Autodesk. His name is Cyrille Fauvel, and he's going to talk to us about their View and Data API. Take it away.
So I don't have any slides like the other guys. It's all based on the browser. WebGL is really great. We can do very cool things, from particles to games to whatever you want, special effects. And at Autodesk, we produce 3D assets, so content. And I think this is where it's difficult with WebGL. You need to be a programmer to create content most of the time. So the idea here is really to bring anything you produce using different tools to WebGL. And I'm not only talking about the Autodesk software. We're capable of bringing any file format which exists around the world to WebGL in a very easy way. And what I'm going to demo here very quickly is it could be very, very simple. So without any programming, you can just drag a file. So here I'm taking an FBX file. But again, OK, some legal stuff here I have to say. I agree. I hate that. But you see, it uploads the file on our server, and we're going to translate it. So this file, I know, is pretty quick, so we can wait a few seconds while I talk. But the goal is really, you know, you bring that to the browser, and we load it into your browser, and you can start to manipulate it. In our API, it's not only about bringing the geometry to the web browser. We bring more than just the geometry. Okay, so here, let me just zoom in. It's just a monster. I downloaded it from TurboSquid this morning. Yeah. So it's not only about the geometry itself. We bring metadata as well. So depending on the file format you drop into our API or our web page, we'll bring more than the geometry, all the metadata, all the hierarchy you use to build the file. So if you have an inventor file, which is for mechanical industry, every part, every subassemblies, everything you do, even if you name a part, will be present in the browser as well. And you can do search. So if you have something named like door, say door brings all the models, and you can select them. You can see how the thing is implemented. So pretty handy. There was an Autodesk web page. This is a Node.js application. I can do exactly the same thing, just drag and drop a file into my own web page or my mobile application. And if I want, I can display it as well. So that's another example where if I go here, oh, I have an error. Oops. Not really important. Yeah, it's important. I wanted to show you something. Okay, I'll do it later if I have time. yeah, all demos. Yeah, I explain later. I'll take that for the end. But this is a Star Wars ship that someone provided me. So it's an STL file. Artists are working on it, on the design it. So we can really go from different file formats. So that's the monster again. The only thing which is missing right there, so again, from TurboSquid this morning, we're not yet supporting animation. That's something we still need to work on. So that one was a carnivore plant with animation. As you can see, it's static. But what's interesting, you can really, you see how effective it is when I move things. It's very, very, very good feedback. And this is AC, so it's handheld. So this one is coming from a Revit file, but any model, you can bring it very easily to WebGL. On this is a structure I was talking about. So if, for example, the file contains more than just a 3D model and you want to see the first floor plan, you can see it. So it's 2D, 3D, with metadata. If you want to interrogate the database behind, you can select items. You can just change the view of the house. On get inside, you see that it's pretty quick. If you're interested by the API, where did I put this? Here. Just go to our developer page. So we created a GitHub IO page because it's a lot easier. And again, you see the viewer is integrated. And actually, we have plenty of samples on that page where you can have integration into Facebook, into Typepad, into any website. It's very, very easy to integrate that into your web application or even your mobile application. And again, not only geometry. I'm sure I'm missing something. Let's move on to, where did I put that? Yeah, this one. So Nop, who is sitting right there, did work recently on making the viewer better because we're still developing it. And he did develop a couple of things. So this is a developer version, which will come in about a few weeks into the production server. But you see, he added something like reflection, ground reflection to the. So you have full control on how things are working into the viewer, and you can have even more control if you're interested. I won't go through all of them. Yeah, but you get some good reflection. You get also turn on and off the some shadow thing. Did I turn it on? So ambient shadow. You see, when I turn it on off, very easy. And really, Autodesk is here to bring assets to WebGL. That's really what we want to do on help with. Right now, I think we support a bit more than 50 file formats. But the goal is virtually to support any file format. So right now, I know we support OBG, all the Autodesk-based software, but SolidWorks, Blender, Collada, etc. We can translate that to WebGL very, very easily. The last thing is, if you're interested, so you go to our view on data API. It doesn't have a nice name. I'm sorry for that. The name crap, but our marketing department doesn't want to change it. I wanted something more, whatever. not really nice. So the API is divided in two parts, actually. So you have the REST API, which is there for the conversion, translation to an easy web light format. In short, it's just JSON objects with streaming to the viewer. So this is where all the conversion is happening on our server using REST API. On the client is really built on top of 3GS. and we had a framework on top of 3GS to support different shaders. You can write your own tools. So some tools will come into the viewer, like markers, sectioning, and more. So we're developing tools to help designers to control the viewer itself. And it's full open source. And WebGL is very powerful because I did an experiment with our own viewer. You know, I thought Google Cardboard are around, you have Oculus Rift. Why not turning that into something where you can have a true 3D experience? So I have an example where your phone on the Google Cardboard, you can see models directly in 3D without changing anything into our technology. Just write it yourself. It's working. The last thing I want to mention is something I'm also working with Tony right now, is GLTF, which is another file format for WebGL. So that's something Tony is working on. And I wrote a FBX converter. It's not yet finished, but it's working. And the viewer will be able to convert to that format as well. You know, it's just JSON object. What else? Do you have any questions?
Don't forget to repeat the question. Can I write my own viewer using the View and Data API? So I don't need to just embed your viewer into my app. I can use that as an API and make my own.
Yeah, so the only problem here is, so you have access to all the files, textures, everything, all the information. The only problem is that we haven't yet documented the file format behind. It's JSON object, but you need to understand it. But the answer is straight. You can, but right now it might be difficult.
How do materials work? Can I author a shader graph in Maya and expect it to come over?
So yes, there is a framework for that. So let me show you.
Sorry, I'll repeat the question.
Oh yeah, can you implement your own shader into our viewer? Sorry, the answer is yes. We have a framework where, for example, for the VR experience I did, I needed to change the context for drawing into our viewer, so I created my own and had a warp shader for having, you know, the curve deformation by the lens. So yes, the answer is straight yes.
Okay. What about the fidelity of bringing materials over from 3D Studio from Maya?
So we're not yet supporting Maya, which is very strange,
yeah.
But we support Max. And the material for Max, as long as they are materials we can really identify, are working great, like the protein material from Autodesk on the default materials. If it comes with your own material where you need your own shader, we'll take all the parameters, we'll put that into the file, but you still need to provide your own shader.
Are you supporting dynamic instantiation and geometry?
So can you support dynamic instantiation of geometry? Yes. So it's not because all the geometry which appear on this viewer right now is static. You can create your own geometry. And actually, if I select an object, you see I'm adding some geometry just to align the object. But you can create your own geometry. You can actually modify the geometry. So once the viewer has loaded everything, you want to move things, you want to change the material, you want to know the volume of the object, or you want to bring a second file into it, everything is possible. So it's purely, the viewer is, you know, is purely JavaScript. And we have a framework where you can add shaders, plugins, on everything. One more question?
What file format do you think is best for WebGL?
The best file format for WebGL.
There's
no straight answer to that one. you can use...
What was the question?
Yeah, so...
The question.
Yeah, sorry. What is the best file format for WebGL? I don't have a very good answer. I mean, every day I use OBG file because this is what I need in what I'm doing every day. But, you know, I repeat what I say. Tony is working on a file format which might be the best one for WebGL coming. So I'll let Tony to comment on that. But you know, there's no best file format. It's how you can bring things easily into WebGL. And right now, if you look at 3GIS, you have a plugin to load different file formats, maybe like five or six. You have OBG, you have DAE, I can't remember the list, but all of them have their quirks, and there's no straight answer. You know, it's material support is a big issue. If you don't know how to translate the materials, then you're stuck. You have the geometry, but it doesn't look right. So that's why I say you need to be a programmer to really get what you want. But if you can have a common file format where you can specify your shaders and the geometry, and for us more, because in our industries we need the metadata as well, then you're good.
Okay,
thank you.
Ross, you're next. Yeah, thanks. That was great, Cyrille. There is no one-size-fits-all file format for WebGL. Some of the work we're doing with GLTF we think is going to make it a good format for delivering WebGL. It's going to be compact. It's going to stream easily if you want to build streaming systems with it, but it won't cover every feature you could possibly imagine. If anybody here is local, and if you're not on the Silicon Valley WebGL Meetup group, you might want to join that. So we had a baby a few months ago, and we spawned a South Bay Meetup group for people who live down that way, because they can't always get up to SF. And so they are having their next one during NVIDIA's GPU Tech Conference, GTC. And you get a free one-day pass to GTC to go see the meetup and go in that day, and that's March 18th, I believe. And I'll be speaking at that meetup and talking about GLTF, so we can talk more about that then. And in the meantime, back to our program. So this is Russ McKegney, the founder and CEO, from Verold, who's going to talk to you about their wonderful authoring environment.
Great. A lot more people here than last year, which is pretty exciting. I think last year there were 20 of us pitching to each other about how cool WebGL is. Yeah, exactly. It's exciting to see the range of things, and even just walking around the show floor at GDC, that, you know, like WebGL is real. We've been playing with this thing for 3 years or more, and it's getting to be real, and the various people in the room are all working in different areas, and we're kind of finding our niches. For us at Verold, we built basically a game engine and an editor around building 3D content. And our niche is really around trying to make it easy for people to build interactive presentations from their content. So whether that's architecture content, so, you know, good for us to follow the Autodesk group. We're part of their Cloud Accelerator program starting next week. So we're going to be, you know, to your question about can you take their data format and turn it into more, yes. We're going to be taking BIM data and adding our storytelling tools on top of it, which is you know, great to see. So basically what we do is we build tools to make it easy to produce interactive presentations, whether that's educational content, product marketing, architecture visualization, design review, all the different kinds of things that a stakeholder might want to do with 3D interactive content that you know, until now hasn't been possible. Until now, 3D content's been locked into these proprietary tools. And more we're using 3D content, and more it's important, but we're trying to make that content easier and more accessible. So this is a, you know, first demo. I really love this demo. Mike, our engine developer, wrote this one. There's no code here. This is using visual tools, basic design patterns like the concept of shots, the concept of cinematic effects. These are 3D models off TurboSquid with some annotations, some shots. And, you know, if you compare communicating this story as an interactive presentation like this versus, you know, text description on Wikipedia or a video, it's much more engaging. You know, if it's for a student, the student can jump in and learn about this. So this is the Orion launch that happened late last year. Teaching about the launch, the mission, and again, simple demo, kind of half a day of work, and you've got something that's pretty compelling. We work in education. Pearson is in the process right now of migrating most of their textbooks to online. And so as you think about what does a textbook look like, what's the digital equivalent of that that's running on your tablet or your phone or your desktop, the illustrations that were written 50 years ago, as they migrate that stuff to digital, it's sometimes being migrated to infographics, sometimes to video, sometimes to interactive. And so we're powering some of that. And so the Orion model is a great example of that. In the e-commerce space, you know, we've been really waiting on browser support, you know, having WebGL everywhere. Because until WebGL's everywhere, you're not going to see Amazon putting all of their products online this way. But it's, you know, we're getting there. And I think, you know, this is a very crude demo, but when you can show an interactive photograph like this and give the customer the ability to explore the content, make it load fast, make it look good, it's going to be one of those things where the frontier of the web just evolves and moves forward, and you just won't go back. If you see a photo on a website that doesn't move and doesn't interact, you're going to be like, what the hell? Like, this is not what I want from you guys. So it's one of those things where we're still early, but you look out 2 to 5 years, and it's going to be kind of everywhere. And whether it's just a simple product display or, you know, tying in some of the learning, training components that we've built, annotations, assembly of models together, you know, ways to kind of explore content, and you know, this is partly technical challenge. It's also partly a user experience challenge. We're still in the process of figuring out what does it look like when you deliver media this way, and so we're trying to figure that out, and we're trying to build some of those tools for you guys to make it easier to produce. And so far, actually, everything I've shown you hasn't been any code. This is all just simple demos. But if you want to write code, of course you can. We're built on 3.js. What we give you on top of, this is on a Heroku server. It's going to take a second to spin up. What we give you on top of 3.js is tools to bring your, just like the Autodesk platform, we give you tools to easily bring your professional 3D content to the browser. We give you a component entity framework for writing components and code. We give you a loader. We give you a bunch of hosting solutions, ways to bring your content to life. But if you want to dive in and write code, you can. This is a project we did with Tesla last year, where one of their research labs was testing the remote door opener for the device. And so they built a rig where they literally, you know, put these openers on a track and moved it into every possible position in 3D space around the car. They gave us an Excel spreadsheet with all the stuff.
Do you think that's better?
I think the battery
just
died.
I'll
take that.
Yeah. Is this better? Okay, so they gave us an Excel spreadsheet with all the data, and again, Mike over there loaded that up into a set of particles, and this is at a trade show, an auto show in Munich, they showed this off as a way to present that data that's much more compelling again than an Excel spreadsheet. So you start to see again kind of the design patterns coming together, the new kinds of interaction, assembling basic features. And this is my last demo. So this one is another fun example. This is a good friend of mine.
13, right?
It's totally PG-13. My joke is we have Government of Ontario funding, and we can't do anything that's not PG-13. This is my friend Alex Henry, who has a scanning array that captures very high quality 3D content. So this stuff's not, you know, this one's not animated, again, you know, cinematics, some basic storytelling, ways to explore the content, and this is really kind of let's not look at that one. this is still a work in progress. There's some geometry bugs there.
Bugs in the scanning.
Our stuff is totally cool. So as an example, this content is from an online interactive tattoo magazine. Last year at Unite, it won best non-game app at Unite. It was built in, the first version was built in Unity, but this is content that doesn't belong in Unity. This is content that belongs on the web. They want to be shipping this stuff all the time. And so hence, you know, looking at Verold as a way to deliver that content.
So that's that's some of our latest examples. Our biggest announcement from the show this week is Mixamo. Have you guys used Mixamo before?
Right.
Yeah. Have you used it this week? No. Yes. So Mixamo, for those who don't know, Mixamo is a way for a small design team to work with animation content without hiring an animator. So you literally can upload your character, auto-rig the character, and apply animations from their library of 10,000 animations. And so if you've used it before, it used to be built in Unity, and loading this would probably have taken you 3 minutes. Now it loads immediately. So it's all web-based. We're streaming animations in real time, so as you click a new animation, we're literally streaming that animation data one frame at a time. And so it starts buffering. The geometry takes a second, but the animations load almost instantaneously. It's literally faster to load the animation here than it is in Maya, which is crazy. So we're pretty excited about this. I mean, this shows kind of the pipeline opportunities and that we can do. I mean, this is not the best character to show, but pick a different one, not a horse. But it's just beautiful. I mean, if you're building tools for developers and artists to work with, you now have web-based platforms to do that with, and so that's a compelling use of our technology as well. So, any questions for me or for Mike? Rendering questions will go to Mike.
I'll start it off.
Sure.
I'm gonna ask a question I ask every year around this time. Is the client open source?
The client is not open source.
Are you thinking about or planning on doing that?
Yes. Yeah.
Can you tell us more?
So, we talk about this every year.
Every year.
My goal with the engine is to make it open source. I think it has to be open source for people to get really behind it. But you give me a few weeks.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
Yeah. Awesome. Yes.
What do you think about coherent UI?
What do I think about? Coherent UI. I don't know what that is.
Don't forget to repeat the question.
Oh, what is? Maybe someone of you guys wants to answer it. What do you think of coherent UI? Do you want to say more?
Just Google it. It's awesome.
Okay. I think it's probably awesome. Yes.
Did you run into any browser limitations or issues trying to partner with Mixamo?
Oh, did we run into any browser limitations working with Mixamo? We still have a couple of shader issues on iOS 8. We went live with this. I mean, this was a relatively small project, small timeline to get this out, like everything else we do. So desktop is working great. Mobile, they're a fully responsive website, and we mostly work mobile, but we have a few shader issues in iOS 8 that I think Mike is actually fixed, but they haven't taken the pull request yet. But on desktop, I don't think there were any. Yes.
Just from a process point of view, so your client's built on 3.js, but your rest of your infrastructure is not open source. I understood the question correctly.
Right.
So then, how do we programmatically extend the client with our own capabilities?
The question.
Okay. So the question is, since our client is not open source, how do you extend it? Most of what, our layer on top of 3.js is relatively thin. We provide a component entity framework that's pretty straightforward, and we provide the loader with a shader system and a bunch of things like texture fallbacks and other features like that. So if you want to get into that code, then that's just difficult because you've got to go into code that we don't document very well. But for the most part, when you're extending an application, you're writing 3.js code, and that's all well documented. You can work with that. And we get when you export a project from Verold, you get everything. So you can dig in there and change the 3.js code. Over time, we will get better at documenting. We're an 8-person team. We're trying to manage a lot of things. But the goal is ultimately that the engine's open source. We've been mostly focused on our editor, trying to make it easy for you to make. Like to get at least 80-90% of the way there before you export, and then you write your code in 3.js on top of that.
This is a follow-up question to kind of put a point on it. So using that Tesla example, yep. Is one. So your code then when it exports into 3.js JavaScript, you have that. How do you know that the name of the object is the thing that the car is where it is? And is that documented or regular somehow, or what's the?
So. Yeah, maybe we can take it offline, but high level, you get a scene object from Verold, which is a wrapper of the 3.js scene. You get assets in Verold that are wrappers of 3.js objects. And so in that Tesla example, the car and setting up all the materials in the car is something you do in our editor because it's super easy to do visually. The point cloud of data, you're just going to use 3.js and draw that point cloud beside the car. And you know where the car is in space because you set it to 000 or wherever you set it. Like so it's Yeah. Our engine is a wrapper layer on top of 3.js, so you can always dig down underneath and go straight there. Okay, come and talk to us after.
It's looking beautiful, Ross. So if people are excited about Mixamo, save the date. I think it's going to be April 15th at Geekdom. Mixamo will be the featured speaker at the next WebGL meetup. They're going to talk about what you just saw that they built on Verold. Great stuff, and I think it's going to be Stefano Carrazzo, the CEO, who's going to be doing that talk. In the meantime, Peter's getting set up. Very good. How many people in the room own a mouse? It's a trick question. A trick answer? Who said that earlier? The lav mic is dead. Did we get the lav mic fixed? No, we're going to do handheld, so when you're ready. Well, you might not want to throw it out yet, but you might want to try doing some other kinds of input, and that's what Peter is going to talk to you about.
So this will be an interesting talk today because it's about how to build a viral app, which clearly nobody knows. So either this will work really well, or I'll be some crackpot on a stadium or podium. But one of the things that really sort of annoys me is when people throw virtual reality, as you might see it in Unity or something else, into the same bucket as WebVR. Because as we know, web is super different, it's fast to load and all those things. I sort of break it down, the web, that is, into two categories, content and navigation. And when I think of viral apps, I'm thinking of things like Instagram or Facebook or Craigslist. And all these things sort of like have a very uniting theme of, okay, here's something that's personal to me in my life, whether it's what I'm doing or eating for breakfast, or maybe it's something I'm trying to sell. Anyway, that's all content, which is going to be mostly what we're talking about today. And then there's navigation, which is an even bigger unknown and perhaps even more pertinent to virtual reality, because what we're used to is clicking a link, and when it comes to VR, that could be flying through a world or pushing a button or swirling through a WebGL2 logo could indicate some form of navigation. So there's a lot we really don't know right there. This is sort of the theme of this talk is how do we bring out content and navigation, explore those as their own things in WebVR? Because we got to do that. Also in the web, there's these two other things that I think make it possible, which are clearly giant pictures of squirrels. it's the ability for Instagram to be run by a 4-person team, or someone to be messing around in their college dorm and think, oh, this is a really stupid idea. I'm going to build it and trick my friends, and then a website appears that wouldn't otherwise have existed. So I think a lot of sort of the really enticing things about the web are sort of things built on a lark or maybe started from a lark. And because web is so componentized and easy and all these things that real programmers like to mock, like JavaScript and jQuery, actually make it easy to build abusable components that you can chuck together and prove out some idea. So I think that's really important to think about as we go forward with WebGL. And I know many people are sort of thinking about this already, like you get Glam and web components and things like that, Polymer, sort of putting these together. So I know that's happening, and I'm not even the most up to date on all that. But what I'm here to talk about is how LeapJS sort of plays into all this, because it's one tiny little part of this bigger thing on WebVR. But I'm going to talk about how, when we're designing our APIs and our libraries, how we're trying to fit this paradigm. So to first give you a little background, this is how LeapJS works. You've got your LeapMotion controller that's got cameras on it and LEDs. You can see your hands. It talks to software on your computer, and that hosts a WebSocket server, which any page can connect to, and get a frame data at 60 or 110 FPS. And that data is really simple. It's just the positions of all the joints on your hands. Now there's this nice little layer on top of that, where you can have these, we call them LeapJS plugins, which are architected and inspired by jQuery plugins or AngularJS directives or things like that. But the idea is you have these points coming through, and then you might have a stack of other pieces of software that manipulate them. Maybe they transform them or render them or something. And then you've got your web application on the bottom, which reads them in. So here's a good example of one of those plugins. It's called the Bone Hand. And this is pretty neat because with a few lines of code, as you can see, you get a hand. And this makes a whole lot of problems just go away, especially for someone just starting with 3.js. There's no, oh, my camera's pointing 180 degrees the wrong direction, because it creates a scene for you if you want it to. And that takes care of lighting and shadows and other things like that. So the idea is make things really, really quick. I should mention here that also you can pass in your own scene by just leaving out that argument and putting in scene, my scene. But there it is, a somewhat configurable hand. And you can see that this is quite easy to even simplify further. You've just sort of got this leap.loop controller constant, which is on the global object. So you could even change the API to be something more markup based. So it's all there. It's doable when we're good and ready. But you've got these hands. They're on your web page. Whoop-de-doo, right? Okay, I can move my hands around. I can wave at people. Wonderful. No, we want to do more things than that. So we started out building some other things that hands can touch and interact with. And we came up with the interactable plane library. And what you're looking at here is a screenshot of a VR browser. I think it's MozVR. And then these planes that you can touch with your fingertips and move them around. And this is a similarly simple API. It goes in and, I don't know why it's cut off there. But yeah, there you create an interactable plane, you pass in your 3.js mesh, and then you pass in a few configuration options, and there you go. And these are nice, they're modular, they all work independently. You can put four up and then touch them all and move them around. And the idea is that these can sort of start off by sort of trying to evict the current paradigm of, I'm going to build my really cool WebGL scene, and then I'm going to clutter it with my two-dimensional buttons on the side that sort of control how it works. It seems like it would be more nifty if you could just stay in virtual reality. So yeah, I'll get to more on that in a little bit. There's one other thing, which is buttons, another two-dimensional concept pulled over back into three dimensions again. And I'll show you a quick demo of sort of what these look like when built into something, if you guys are interested. Okay, so you've heard of MozVR, perhaps. We did a fork a while back and tried putting some of these components into Mozilla's existing code, and this is what it looks like. This is just sitting in our GitHub right now. But anyway, there's links there. You've got your hands out. You can go between different worlds by bringing up a second hand and then clicking the button, and it takes you, I think there's an iframe loading in the background here, it takes you to another world. There's a LeapMotion demo, then you go in, you go back to your first world again. So we're looking at buttons, we're looking at those planes objects, and we're looking at these hands. And then on top of that, we threw in a few affordances to make it easier to understand three dimensions, like you see the shadows on the hands and the shadows under the big icons. So there's a lot there that makes that useful. There's a problem, is that it's still really just 2D. What we've got is a bunch of 2D planes immersed in a 3D world. And in that demo itself, you're sort of pivoting like a head stuck in a position in space. And you're able to look at these things, but you're not really able to go anywhere. And this is sort of, we have to work into this phase and then go beyond it, I think, because we need to, like, we have all this existing 2D content. When you have a page and a piece of text, you can only see it in two dimensions. Text is great for two dimensions. But there's many things beyond that. Let me see. We're almost near the end here. I'm going to go on a little bit of a tangent and say that there's like many other types of 3D input devices that you could imagine. Like, you could imagine taking these planes here and saying, what if you could deform them with your fingertips? What if they could bend under your fingertips and things like that? That would be a great way to like make it a better demo. You could go the other way and say, like, here I am, I'm building a viral app. I want this to be not just some images I found and put onto this website, I want these to be my images. And that becomes much more difficult, because what you see right now are just things that serve from my site on a 3D texture, and you can't really put, say, a chunk of DOM into the same context, because right now in browsers, the WebGL and the DOM are in sort of different rendering pipelines. So if we had that, it would let us do some neat things. So I just wanted to mention that. And then I also think there are sorts of types of inputs that we don't even imagine as possible yet. Like, what if you've got your standard text field input, which is made the web run. But what if you had a 3D input where you go in, you pitch a point, and you say, I'm going to set three numbers at once just by moving my hand through space. So there's ideas in there. And there's probably many, many, many I haven't thought of. So I'm going to leave you with a couple of interesting questions that I've just sort of, I don't even know how to answer them myself. But you got 3D, and we've got all these like immensely difficult to render things that were just like a million particles, 2 million particles, whatever. There's a lot of work to be done to make that work really well. And on top of building it, then there's a huge another layer of work is like, how do you make all these particles, how do you make them into a visual affordance? How do you design for a 3D world that sits in a certain way? And how do these particles indicate something about the world or something, some way that you should interact with it? To build it into an experience instead of just a piece of visual candy. That's really tough, because there's so much more to work with. And so the two questions I wanted to leave you with were, how are people going to represent themselves? And that can be like whether they're selling a car on Craigslist or taking a photo on Instagram or I don't know what it is, maybe a volumetric photograph is the way of the future, or a piece of art or a sculpture. So input and content. And then even more future than that, is augmented reality. Is when you go, instead of here's a virtual world that I'm traveling through, what if the web is all around me in this room and that thing right there is glowing because there's some data attached to it? Is that like actually the web where you're going page by page? Or is it just enhanced by a backbone of like HTTP and TCP and there's not really pages anymore? I don't know. That's it. Do you guys have any questions? Yeah.
Do you have any demos at the back?
Yes, we have demos at the back. You should try them out. They're sweet. Yeah.
Can you tell people a little about Lead.js?
You're wondering if I can tell people about Leap.js. And so there's this diagram here, which has basically the flow of data going through Leap.js. It's available on js.leapmotion.com. You can get it. We have a CDN there. As well as the plugins and other things I talked about today are all there or on our developer gallery.
Yeah, please put that link up on the meetup page.
Yeah. They got cut off on my slides here, unfortunately, jslemotion.com and such. Yeah, I'll post links to this entire talk on the meetup comments. Shannon, yeah?
Yeah. I see
You could do this quite, I think, not without too much difficulty in either an Angular directive, or I haven't tried this, but a Polymer component, I think, can do the same thing. Yeah. Cool. Thank you, guys.
Great job. Thank you, Peter. We're going to take a couple minutes break from the presentations. Good time for a quick refresh and bio break if you want, but we're not going to stop the action. I want to do a couple of announcements. First, Shannon, would you come up and talk to folks about Silicon Valley WebGL?
Hey, so I'm Shannon, and we have an upcoming WebGL meetup in Silicon Valley. I think it's on March 18th. And it's going to be at the GTC conference, the GPU Developers Conference. So it'll be at the San Jose Convention Center, if anybody's interested in coming. Basically, as a side effect of gaining admission into the event, you show up at registration and you get a ticket to see GTC's expo for free. So it's kind of a cool in. So far, the agenda is in portrait. There it comes. We've got Khronos Group going to give us an update on like what Khronos does, how they affect our industry and stuff like that. I'm very interested to understand this better. NVIDIA is going to give us a talk on the shader development, stuff like that. Going to get an update from the awesome team at Google about kind of a sneak peek on WebGL 2. Tony Parisi, you may have heard of him. Some guy, kind of he has a food show. It's called, what is it? Your food show? No. It's called No Reservations. It's a side job he has. Anyway, we have Autodesk coming as well. They have some really cool tools and whatnot for exporting 3D objects, and they have a thing called 1-2-3D Capture, I think it's something like that. It's interesting subjects. And anyway, come, have fun, and I'm done.
You know what, you don't want to tell people about VR camp at Burning Man, Shannon?
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that.
Just in case.
Just in case.
Still PG-13, remember.
Still PG-13. So, right, if you're into virtual reality and making the world a better place, and possibly into Burning Man, we have the first ever VR camp. It's going to be at Burning Man this year. It's going to be a pretty big deal, pretty big set of screens, 20-foot by 30-foot screens. Big demo booths, probably about 6 or 8 stations on either side, so about 16 continuous demo stations running all the time, and just it's all about spreading the word of virtual reality. It's not about commodification or making money or selling rigs. It's about, you know, spreading the beautifulness that we're seeing in VR. Like, because every time I see some really cool demo, I just think, God, I want the rest of the world to see this. So that's what it's about. If you're interested, ring me up. Shannon at bmanvr.com.
Nice. So. Thanks again, Shannon. Iker, where are you? Iker, you can come get set up. Did everyone leave a business card on the way in, if you still print those things? Anybody want to get in on this raffle? We have a raffle happening here. We're going to raffle off a Khronos Group backpack to a lucky winner. And Angela Chang from the Gold Standard Group, who helps Khronos do all their marketing and events, is going to come up and do the raffle. Angela?
Okay, so the first thing is a backpack from Khronos. It's a really pretty backpack. What's the name? Rita Tokaski?
Rita!
Rita!
We're raffling off one more prize, a brand new in-the-box Leap Motion controller.
Thank you.
It's a bundle. It's a Leap Motion controller. Tell them about it.
We have the Leap Motion controller and the cables for it. Thank you to Leap Motion for putting this up.
That's what I said.
In layman's terms.
Yes, exactly. So the VR bundle Leap Motion. Angela, do the honors.
Palma. I said Palma.
Come on up, Tony. We actually have one more. We have another Leap Motion VR developer mount. Yeah, thank you. So This lets you mount your Leap Motion on the front of your VR headset, such as an Oculus Rift. Again, courtesy from our wonderful friends at Leap Motion. Angela?
Oh, I like the color.
Thank you.
Julian E. James? Gomez.
Julian Gomez. Come on up, Julian.
Okay, so just three quick announcements that actually all relate to WebGL. So one is, do check out, for any people who are interested, where technology meets art, especially if you know artists, 3D Web Fest. It's a really cool festival where we're trying to help community promote more collaboration between technology, WebGL developers, and then also experience artists. Pretty cool stuff going on there, so check that out.
What's the URL?
Oh, good. What is the URL? The URL is 3dwebfest.com, so check that out. We will put that on the meetup. I'll also put these other two. Next month, we are going to host another VR hackathon for those that are interested in virtual reality, but it's not just VR. It's also immersive tech and others. There was some pretty good WebGL representation there last time, so go WebVR. And then the last thing I'll announce is the architecture, engineering, construction hackathons that are going on. This is the building industry, so again, this is something that only affects everyone that lives or works in a house or building. So a multi-trillion dollar industry that at least has three or four hacks at every single one that uses WebGL. Right, so if any of the developers in here are interested, the next one that we're going to have on the West Coast, well, actually up here in the Bay Area, because there are two in California now, is probably going to be at Facebook again a little bit later on in the year. But for anyone that's interested in that one, if you're not based here, they're popping up all over the world now, go to aechackathon.com. And so those are the three announcements.
We have three more speakers. The next one is Iker Jamato from Lude. And he's going to talk about making WebGL run everywhere, especially mobile, and making it great. Iker, here's the mic.
No, I have one. Yeah. Okay. Hello, everybody. Really excited to be here another year. And I wanted to take the chance to just briefly comment a little bit about the platform that we have, the services that we offer. Also, I want to do a couple of announcements of the things that we have been doing during 2014 and 2000, and that we're going to release in 2015. And also, as it's GDC, right, show you a couple of games that are actually HTML5 and WebGL games that have been published using our platform. So, what is Q&As? What is our product from Lude? Well, it's a bunch of services that we offer to help HTML5 or web developers. I prefer to say web than HTML5. It will change eventually in the future. So if you're a web developer and you really want to create and monetize native-like applications across multiple platforms, we offer you services to be able to do that successfully. So this is an overview of what we do. We are not on the left side of the slide. Here is where there's a lot of tools to build applications and games using web technologies, and we're not offering those services. You can use whatever platform you like. There are great tools, as you are seeing now, for WebGL. People from Verold, from Play Canvas, that they will show you some pretty amazing stuff later. Even Unity nowadays, so, and Unreal Engine, we didn't mention that one, but it's also going there to HTML5. So you can use those kind of tools, that's perfectly fine. As long as you generate web content, we take care of the next step if you really want to go cross-platform. So what we offer is testing and debugging tools, so you can just test on the device directly, you can see the performance that you are going to get from the different services that we offer, you can access the native features if you really need to monetize or to engage your users. And then when you are comfortable with the results, you can go to the cloud compiler and with one click, you can just generate the different bundles for different platforms. That's the main idea here, right? Web developers are used to the web, and the web is pretty different in a lot of features and tools from the native side. So we try to break that gap between the web and the native side, right? So in essence, what we do is we wrap your web content and we offer it for different platforms, and we know how each platform behaves or you have to go there, right? So what are the services that we offer? The wrapping, definitely, is something that you can do on your own, definitely, but I've been in this space for 4 years now, and I can tell you that it's not as easy as it seems. It depends on your project, definitely. But one of the things that we are offering is we replace the basic or the usual runtimes that are on mobile, especially. We offer two different options apart from the regular WebView. It's not that we don't like the WebView. Actually, we even offer the WebView. You can use it if you want to. The WebView is this component that is on the operating system, so as many of you know, that you can execute web content inside, right? But we replace it for two other options. Jewel of the crown is Canvas Plus, is our little baby. We built it 4 years ago. I built it myself in C++ and Objective-C in Java. We built a mini browser. So it's a technology that runs HTML5 or web standard APIs, but it's just a subset of it. As the name claims, it's only for canvas rendering. The good things for this environment is that it's highly specialized. It has plenty of very good features. You can ask me afterwards if you want to. For example, it was the first, we announced it 2 GDCs ago that we supported WebGL apart from the Canvas 2D API on iOS, even 5 at that time. Now we only support iOS 6. And Android 2.3, you still support Android 2.3 and above. So you can definitely have WebGL running everywhere. Then the other option is WebView Plus. Why another runtime if you have that one? Then, as I said, it's a limited version of a browser, so you might need more features from the web content, and you cannot wait until we add them to the platform. So we have WebView Plus, what we call it. It's an advanced WebView. In this case, what we are offering is a Chromium-based project for Android 4.0 and above, and we are integrating. We are the only platform, that's, as far as we know, that we are offering WK WebView. Is the latest WebView that it's in iOS 8 that has all the features that Safari has. For example, what it has is a faster JavaScript thanks to a JIT compilation using the Nitro engine that Apple has, right? So we offer this kind of like placements of the runtime. It's really, really easy to use them. It's just one click, so you don't have to like deal with complex algorithms or features to add them. It's just you can test them right away. But we also take care of all the other features that are on the native side. We add APIs that are not in the web standard for advertising, for in-app purchasing, for push notifications. You need those kind of things when you really want to be successful on mobile, especially nowadays. So we offer those APIs in a very cross-platform way. I will talk actually of one of the things that we just released. We all have advanced features like very advanced memory management. As I said, in that canvas environment, we can do whatever we want. We just build it ourselves, and we can add these kind of like cool features. And of course, we don't respect the standard for that one. But if you really need those features because you have a very big project that needs to run, and some of our customers do use those features, you can have them. We have physics acceleration with the same API for Box2D, and we also have an implementation that hasn't been released for MoJS with a hook to bullet, live reload, live update, and a very low footprint. And memory management, as you can see, this is the iOS WebView. The memory footprint can be very, very low in our platform. So news, as I said, some news. That was a brief overview of the platform. There's much more to talk about, of course, but I don't want to bore you. And so one of the things that we mentioned a couple of months ago, and we showed it actually at the WebGL Meetup, that it was in the Valley, is that we support Android Wear. This is a side project that we did it internally. We wanted to know if our very specialized environment was able to run in a very, very high demanding environment as a smartwatch, or even in Google Glass, and we make it run. Those environments, they don't have a web environment. So we are taking those web content for these kind of platforms. I will show it to you afterwards. We're also about to release. We didn't make it to GDC. It's really hard to have a deadline, but we are rebuilding our cloud compiler, and the biggest announcement that we're doing is that we are fully compatible with what is de facto a standard for application wrapping, the hybrid application wrapping, that is Apache Cordova. So you will have all the benefits from Apache Cordova and all the benefits for all the features that I mentioned. So you can still have Canvas Plus, and you can still have this memory management. All the APIs that we have for accessing the native side, it will work exactly the same but still you can use plugins that are open source, and it will be available actually in 2 weeks for beta program. So if someone wants to contact me, I will be more than happy to put you inside the beta program. And one of the things that we already released is this project. That is, it was a side project internally, but we think that it might contribute to the community. We call it Atomic Plugins. This is something related to how plugins are built nowadays. If you're building in Unity, you have plugins. If you're building in Cocos2D, you also have some kind of like plugins. Different platforms have those plugins to access features, and also JavaScript to access native features. We saw that that ecosystem is really, really coupled to the platform itself. We wanted to bring a new methodology, and this is the idea behind Atomic Plugins. Just focus on the API, expose it to different platforms the same way. So we offer you some tools for that, and we started with some plugins ourselves. So it's one of the things that we did. And the last announcement is that we are finishing some, we have a pretty big, I think that I'm not afraid to say that it's the biggest HTML5 developer community, gaming developer community out there, with more than 52,000 developers and more than 5,000 games that have been published to the stores. So that doesn't mean that there are no more games. There are more games than that, but the ones that have been finally published to iOS and Android are more than 5,000. So we are signing some deals with companies here in the US, in Latin America, and in China to help those developers get there, right? And also, last GDC, I announced some AR. It was great that they mentioned the future for augmented reality also on the web. It was something I've been doing a lot of research on AR in the past, and I implemented and I exposed a plugin that allows to access augmented reality in the native side. And we're going to release a couple of projects with some customers. I cannot mention still, but I think that they look really, really cool. So, no further ado. Sorry.
Did you bring the AR demos with you to show people?
I have some. I have to set it up, but yeah. Sure. Yeah. Yeah, but the ones are pretty cool. I mean, there's like games and also like interior design things, and so and everything that the WebGL has a lot of potential for that. But yeah, I will try to show them. So, what about games? So, as we are in a WebGL meetup, I'm going to show you a couple of games that one that is still in work in progress and one that we already released. This actually, we love to do research. So this game was has been developed using Dart, actually. And it's using our platform in Android. I think it's the Nexus 4 running here. You can see 60 frames per second there. It's a completely custom-built game engine. We were using 3 years in the past, and we still use it for some projects, but we also love to play around with this kind of things. Well, this game, hopefully it will be released this year. We are now adding all the features that you need to do a successful game, right? But as I said, I'm going to show you a couple of games. From those 5,000, I chose some of the ones that I really like, and they show a lot of potential. So this game has been released, I think, like 3 months ago. It has everything that you need from a mobile game. It has game center integration, Google Game Services integrations. You have multiplayer through those services. You have Facebook integration natively. You have in-app purchasing, advertising. You have, in this case, even the 3D physics that I mentioned. So this is WebGL. This game runs on an Android 2.3 device at 20 frames per second, but it runs. And it also runs on an iPhone 4 at nearly 40 frames per second. So still, and physics for JavaScript is quite demanding. So with those kind of native bindings, you can definitely get a pretty good performance. Actually, you can play against someone else, and you can throw power downs and mess around with their gameplay. And some other games, a little bit more in depth. So this is, most of the games in HTML5, sadly, are more casual games. We are trying to like get more professional people trying to build games in HTML5, but they still are pretty casual. So this game still, it looks pretty good. It has the physics 2D implementation. I'm really bad at this. So it has like, it would be similar to Angry Birds, I would say. We also have this other nice game that it's an endless runner. Also, that other game had in-app purchasing inside. This one has Facebook integration, in-app purchasing, like all them nowadays freemium model, game center integration model features that you need to make. Actually, they have a publisher for this game for iOS. And so yeah, you can see, and it has music, of course, but I don't know if it will run. So, more things to show. Well, some of our customers are Disney and Nickelodeon. They have like 60 games each in HTML5. Some of all these games, I mean, even they're not 3D, they're made in WebGL, actually. A lot of them are using Pixie, that is a rendering engine that uses WebGL or even Canvas 2D, and in our platform they're using. So this is another game that I actually really love the design of this game, and actually it's super fun to play if you like puzzles. It has a very cool design for the menus, how you select the levels, and whenever you go there, it's a magnetic field kind of like game, so you have to try to get these dots and just get outside of the screen, and just really, really, I passed a lot of those levels about a couple of months ago. You have to trust me. This is actually a promo game that was built in Brazil, but the look of the game is really, really, really good. So really, really, really good animations and all the transitions, so very polished game, I would say. To be HTML5, it's sad to say, but it's because there's not a lot of developers. We're trying to get more, even 50,000. It's very, very low compared to some other platforms. So, but you can see that the results are really good, that the performance is good too. So, yeah, bunch of games. And I said, just to finish the Androidware version. So this is, let me just show you the camera here. Not very professional, but at least I think that we can get somewhere. As you can see there, this is a demo that we showed. Actually, this was the first demo that we showed two GDCs ago. So Union Square and our logo inside. And actually, the GPUs on these devices are pretty impressive, actually. So you can have that. Still a lot of work to do there. I mean, like, yeah. But I mean, it was just a research project. There's not a lot of demand for this. So whenever people really ask for these kind of features, I mean, you can build the Androidware application from the cloud, but there's still a lot of work to do. But yeah, so that was more or less. Oh yeah, sure. Do you have any questions or? Sure.
I have a couple of questions, but I'll yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the question is if those games are using divs or just plain WebGL or Canvas 2D. It depends. With our platform, as I mentioned, it's really it might look a little bit complicated to understand, but I will repeat it in the sense of that we support different runtimes. So you can choose whatever you want to publish with us. So you will build a native application, and in the end, it's web content running in a different runtime. If you choose Canvas Plus, that's the one that all those games are using, yes, it's only Canvas-based. So if you have divs, the only thing that we do is we just read them, and we just interpret them, but we don't render anything with them. So for example, if you have divs in a canvas, we will know that, and we will definitely render that canvas. But we won't take care of like all of the styling that you have done on those divs, apart from positioning. If you position those divs to have a canvas in one side of the screen, we definitely read that. We're doing that ourselves, so we're not very, very accurate. So it's better not to use that. I mean, it's better just, for a game, my recommendation, especially for mobile, is just go full canvas, full screen canvas, and don't do those kind of things. But if you also want to do it with the same code that you have on your website, you can still do it, but don't do a very deep hierarchy. For Canvas Plus, if you go for WebView or WebView Plus, you're like you have a full-fledged browser. So the good thing is that you can test right away. You can just click one button, execute it with Canvas Plus. It works great for you. You can go with that one. You select the other one and see the results right away. The performance difference, the results.
Sure.
There is phone gap still.
Cordova.
Yeah.
Or Cordova is phone gap. I'm confused what the relationship of Cordova to phone gap and what you do with Cordova.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
The question.
Yeah, the question is that there was Cordova and phone gap and what is the relationship with that? So first was Cordova. It was a project from a Canadian company that was acquired by phone gap. But they made the decision to open source and provide the project to the Apache Foundation, and it was then when they called it Cordova. And the PhoneGap is an Adobe product that is based on Cordova, right? Cordova would be the open source community-based branch, and PhoneGap would be the Adobe branch, right? Our take is a lot of people are using those kind of tools, so I really think that we need to be compatible with those platforms. So what we are doing is we are building on top of Cordova, and we are offering you the different runtimes, and you can choose which runtime you want, and we are still integrating our native features, and we are exposing them to JavaScript. So so in the end, sure, you can use any plugin from the Cordova community, and you can also use our own plugins that we have. So that's the main idea there, yeah. And we are offering some services that PhoneGap doesn't have and Cordova doesn't have, but it's very, like, you have to like go deep. Sure, one more question? No more questions? Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ika. Alban, are you here?
Yep.
Come on up, man. Long time no see. So we haven't seen these folks. They come from Paris, but by way of New York City these days, right?
Yep.
And it's a company called Sketchfab that makes a wonderful product for sharing and viewing models in a bunch of formats.
So I'm Alban, the co-founder and CEO of Sketchfab, which is also a platform to publish and upload and share and find 3D content. So we make it very easy to upload a variety of formats from the tools you use, and we display them pretty well and pretty fast in the browser. So I'm going to show you a few things tonight. Our latest announcement is that we just added PBR support in Sketchfab, which means you can have much more advanced rendering, lighting, and realistic models in the browser. So here is a cool example of a Fiat. And if you look at it, it's, I don't know how it looks on the screen, but it looks good and it's smooth. So that's our latest additions in terms of technology. We've really upgraded our entire like material system and lighting system. So now we have a lighting editor where you can adjust and update all your lights, materials, and so on. So that's our latest addition. One of the cool things we've been working on is a configurator option. So for our API, letting you basically load a mesh and then adjust. So here it's only the texture, but you would be able to do that with the geometry as well. Hide and show objects, pretty basic stuff. We've also recently added an annotation feature so that you can add like some storytelling, kind of a fourth dimension on your model. So here I'm on the LG website, the French version, showing the LG D-Watch smartwatch. No, it's not a smartwatch, it's a watch. Displayed with Sketchfab, you can go full screen. And then we have those little annotations, super easy to add on the model. We have an autopilot mode, so you can just sit back and go through the annotations and the like the specs of the device. All in the browser, works on your mobile, and so on. Another cool stuff I wanted to show you. So we've spent a lot of energy at Sketchfab integrating with a lot of tools. We are natively built in Photoshop, so you can publish in one click from Photoshop to Sketchfab. And we have done this with a lot of tools and 3D scanning platforms. So as we did this, we saw the content and number of uploads really growing up on Sketchfab. Now we have like 1,000 uploads a day, and it means that the content is starting to match the news and what's happening in the world. A cool example we've seen, I don't know if you've heard of this Ukrainian airport that was destroyed by the Russian army in January. And the next day, a guy flew a drone over the airport to make a 3D capture of the scene. And the following day, it was uploaded on Sketchfab, and here it's embedded on Vice. It got 300,000 views in 12 hours. It just shows like 3D and WebGL as a way to convey information and be really a piece of news. So here you have the airport. It's also annotated, so you can go through several parts. And this model has been embedded in like all the Russian and Ukrainian websites. Crashed our servers, obviously. So that was some of our latest stuff. And when it comes to really reaching a mass audience and bring your content to more people, what you really want to be is integrated where your audience is already there. And we're really proud to announce that Facebook has just added native Sketchfab integration. So, thank you guys. So where's the...
Did they give you $2 billion?
I can't speak about that. I don't know how many iframe providers are supported on Facebook. I guess it's around this number. We're the first interactive format, and it means you can show WebGL content in your Facebook newsfeed, which is pretty cool. Thank you. So it's not only used by cool artists like Dimitri, it's also used by guys like World of Tanks. They have hundreds of millions, maybe not hundreds of millions, millions of users and players, and they're already using these cool features on their newsfeed to showcase some of their tanks in real time in their newsfeed. So I just wanted to show it live. So I'm gonna grab this cool ship from Fractured Space. Gonna add to my Facebook page. Up, and then in like 1 second, it embeds our viewer. I can remove the link. Showing PBR embed in Facebook Live at GDC WebGL Meetup. And here you go. So it's PBR in the browser in your Facebook page. I can go full screen. All the full screen. And so here we go. And the latest stuff I wanted to show. Yeah, in the Facebook newsfeed. And latest stuff I wanted to show is that we started looking into VR and WebVR. And if you open Sketchfab in Chromium and look at the cool Facebook Sketchfab embed in your newsfeed, you'll see that we've added a VR mode right in the embed, which means you can publish Oculus content in your Facebook newsfeed. So, so that's it for us. Any questions?
Wow, are we rich yet, Kent? Well, that's freaking... I mean, you guys who make the browsers must just think this is like what you've been working toward. Like that Donetsk thing with the airport, like the ability to just make and share that as news. Don't need a business model. Somebody did that with their, you know, drone flyover, all kind of DIY like that. Oh my God, that's incredible. Yeah, hats off, man. That is some great stuff, Alban. That's not a question, sorry. Brandon.
But I like it.
So I'm guessing I know the answer to this, but does your fancy embeds work on the Facebook mobile app?
The answer is no. Oh. But I'm meeting with Facebook tomorrow to make this happen.
Good luck.
Thanks.
I love the PBR support. How easy is it to author materials for your PBR import?
That's a good question. So I'm not on the tech team at Sketchfab. We thought it would be only used by a rather limited number of users. And upon announcing it, we've seen like hundreds of models with PBR on Sketchfab. So you assume it's fairly easy. But I don't have a technical answer to that question.
What
was used to make this? I actually am not too sure. I think it was a combination of video. I don't really know. We're working with like specific photogrammetry drone software like Pix40. We're talking to guys like 3D Robotics to be supported in drone share and do more with like drones. But for this one, I don't really know. One more question? No open source question?
Is it open source?
So we're not based on FreeJS, sorry guys. We build our own WebGL framework, and this is open source, but the viewer is not open source. And it's not going to be in the short future.
It's a good thing those demos were so good. Thank you so much, Alban. That was awesome. We're coming to the end of our presentations. If you've been at GDC, you would have seen a lot of great game engine stuff. You would have seen a lot of great WebGL game engine stuff. As Jeff was talking about, you can go into the Mozilla booth and see Firefox showing WebGL 2 game content created by Unity. We also heard, Iker mentioned, Unreal exports to WebGL. These are done using a technology that cross-compiles native C++ game engine code into a pile of JavaScript, a big old pile of JavaScript. That's good as far as it goes, but what's I find more interesting is that rather than taking these old game engines that were built for native and try, you know, doing this hack to get the engine into a web browser, some clever people have built a native game engine in JavaScript from the ground up. The idea being I can use my web browser to author, I can use my web browser to play it back without these cross-compile hacks. One such company is called Play Canvas, who has an incredible game engine and authoring tool. And David Evans is here to tell you all about it.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Yes. Good. So yeah, I'm Dave Evans. I'm the CTO and one of the co-founders of Play Canvas. I entitled this Let's Get Physical, which seeing as all the previous talks seems quite relevant, right? So I don't want to take up too much of your time. There's lots of networking and beer drinking to be done, but I do want to cover quickly what Play Canvas is, because I don't know, actually, how many people have never heard of Play Canvas before? Right, so enough for me to describe it. Cool. Play Canvas is an editor, an engine. It's a JavaScript game engine. It is an editor, which I'm going to show you later. So it's a visual game development tool. We have a 3D view. We can add scripts. You can add particles and all this sort of stuff. And I'll show you a bit more like that. We're a host. We will publish and host your games for you for free. And we're also a network of game developers. So we have tens of thousands of game developers registered on the site using Play Canvas, building games. And you can interact with all of those developers. You can post development logs to the site, and other developers can see that and share it and comment on it and help you build your game. And that's one of the best bits. So we are open source. No need to ask the question. We went open source in June of last year, and as our current stats are there, 1,000 stars, 200 forks, 100 watches. It's all going great. Please, if you're interested, get involved. It's on there, playcanvas/engine. So the editor and engine, here's just a few samples of the features. One of our big sort of unique points is the real-time collaboration. Will and I spent the best part of 20 years working in the AAA games industry in the UK, EA, Activision, Sony, we've worked for all of those guys. And one of the big problems was always, how do you work as a team? And if you go and read the forums about Unity, you will see the biggest complaint is, how do I share my scene with another person? How do I work together? How do I collaborate with someone else? And what we did is we took a leaf out of Google's book with Google Docs, and we thought, from the ground up, it will be real-time collaborative. So you can edit a scene, and everyone else in the who's viewing that scene can see you edit that scene and work together, and it's amazing. I mean, really, you can work with someone. We've built games where the artist was in London, the programmer was in Greece, and we were showing it to people in California, right? It's really cool. A whole bunch of other stuff that you kind of expect if you've built games before. Entity component system, material designer, particle editor, drag and drop asset management, drag an FBX file in, it gets crunched on the server and it's ready to use in runtime. So that's all cool stuff. So this is the editor. So yeah, if you've used Play Canvas before, you will have seen an editor built by me about 3 years ago when I was doing a million other things and it worked, but it perhaps wasn't the best example of a 3D development tool. What we're unveiling this week is our new editor. It's handwritten JavaScript, it's all custom built, it's redesigned to be faster, smoother, the workflows have been rethought through, it looks great, we have a designer who's amazing. So again, I'm not going to go through masses of it, but rest assured, it is awesome. So this guy, you may recognize this little guy, I don't know. But so this was just a thing we built. So 3D view, editor attributes on the left, your scene hierarchy on the left, your editor and attributes on the right, asset management here, launch straight into the game, hide everything. You know, it does what you expect from a game editor, but it's running in the browser, so that's pretty cool. And the real-time collaboration stuff is awesome. One of the other big features we released this year was physically based rendering. So I know you've heard a few bits about that already. You may also have seen that Unreal 4 makes a big deal about this. Unity 5, which is out now. Yeah, so came out this week, also does that. And it is now available in WebGL games along with a load of other places. So a lot of people, there's been a lot of WebGL PBR stuff before. And it's easy to think that, oh, I've just written a shader, here it is, it's WebGL, it's PBR. And that's actually not really the case. It's much more about art workflows and how you build this stuff and making it work, particularly for games where you might have a whole bunch of scenes and data, and it's not just the case of writing a shader and dumping a bunch of textures in it. I think when you look at some of the stuff we do later on, there's like 36 textures involved in doing stuff, and you can't just do that by hand. It has to be you have to be helped out. So I put some of this stuff in, but I'm not sure I'm going to talk too much about it. The workflow for PBR, there's two traditional workflows. There's this metalness one where you have a metalness map, which is usually a one bit black or white for metal, black for non-metal. that's one workflow. Or the other one is where you have this specular map of full color specular, and that determines the specular color on metal. And they're both equivalent, and they're both supported in Play Canvas. Some artists prefer some way, some prefer the other. Some are kind of easier to translate existing assets. So you kind of need both of them, and we have that. One of the other big things is generating pre-filtered environment maps. So if you're just viewing a single mesh, a single model, it's relatively easy. You have one environment map, and that's what you need. If you're walking through a game environment, you can't just have one cube map for that environment. It doesn't work. You go from inside to outside. You go from the white room to the red room. It just doesn't work. So you need that stuff built into the tools where you can place in tools like, here's my probe, as it were, and I'm going to generate my cube map from here, and it generates it offline, and it stores it to the server, and or it stores it somewhere, and then you can use it in your game. So that's the stuff that we're working on right now to get into the Play Canvas editor. It's not quite there yet, but it will be in there very, very soon, like we're talking weeks. So this is a demo we released in about November, which was the first sort of our first iteration of the of the PBR stuff. So this is was built by an artist called Joachim from, actually I'm not sure where he's from, but we essentially we found him on the internet and he'd made some cool stuff and we asked him if we could use it and he said yes. So we built this and you can see how the lighting works and how great it looks. And this runs at 60 frames a second on my mobile phone. You know, this runs everywhere. So that is pretty cool. And I think my next slide is a bit of a comparison. So this is like the traditional rendering model versus on the left versus the physically based rendering model version on the right. And you can see particularly sort of this sort of area where there's a lot of work, there's a lot of texture work to make the lighting and make it work. Whereas with the physical stuff, the texture work is the microsurface. It's the how rough, how smooth. It's the tiny details, and it's much more about the physical properties of the material rather than the artistic style of it. And that's one of the real benefits of PBR, which is you're building materials about the physical properties. You're saying this is a rough surface, this is a metal, this is a plastic, this is whatever. You're not saying, oh, this is under a red light and in shadow, and this is where I paint this texture. So for artists, it's actually a lot easier to work with once they've learned how to do it, because they just need to know what is the properties of this material, what am I building. And it works across engines as well, because it's physically based stuff. Stuff you build in an engine for Unity or Unreal will work in Play Canvas and vice versa, because they all it's physical properties, it's not artistic style. Not that you can't be very artistic with this stuff, that's not at all the case. So that was November, and that was one model and one cube map. And like I said, it was still 36 textures in to build that cube map, but one kind of environment map. And so what we're showing today at GDC is called Seymour, and you can load this for yourself at seymour.playcanvas.com. I probably wouldn't do it on your phone right now, but it probably will work. I will show you. I shouldn't say that, really. So we work with Arm, who are the chip manufacturer. So they make GPU chips, the Mali GPU. And we work with them on one of their existing graphics demos that they displayed earlier last year on they did it as a native Android build. And holy crap, that is WebGL. Look at that. So this is showing a whole bunch of new engine features that aren't quite in mainline yet, but are coming very soon. There is box projected environment cube maps used in here to do the reflections, to do the refraction stuff on there. And there's dynamic exposure. You hopefully can see as you go from light to dark, it simulates the exposure of the eyes. We've got dynamic lighting here. And dynamic shadows. Now, because we're targeting mobile chipsets and mobile devices, this isn't, you can't just do dynamic shadows, expensive dynamic shadows. So what we've actually done is we've pre-baked 5 light maps here and we're blending between them as you move the light and you can see where the shadows change. So that's actually, it appears like a dynamic shadow, but it's actually not, which makes it super fast. And this is the big reveal. There's Seymour himself. And so one of the other big things we had to add for this was support for ETC1 texture compression. Because again, we need to run this on a tablet or on a mobile device, and you just can't do that with PNGs. So texture compression means that the textures are compressed even in VRAM, which means they take up much less memory and stuff like that. So I'm just gonna leave that. I mean, I have another slide, but there's a bunch of stuff. Oh yeah, gamma correction and tone mapping. That is, we use a similar, or the same rather, the same tone mapping algorithm that we use in Uncharted 2. So this is kind of for filmic look. and it makes everything look awesome. And I think there's some comparisons we've got in another presentation, which we can probably, you'll probably be able to see. Fortunately, Will turned up in time because I forgot this. But this runs, so it's running at 60 frames a second solid on my laptop. It runs at between sort of 45 and 50 on this ARM Mali sort of, this is a Galaxy Note 10.1, is that right? Yeah. So, and this is what we're demoing it on at GDC. So this works everywhere, right? It's amazing. I say this works everywhere. We didn't write PVRTC texture support yet, so it won't load on an iPhone at the moment, but it will very soon. So that's CMOR, and that is pretty awesome. And I have one more thing, if I can find my mouse pointer. Yeah, there you go. So this is the other thing we're showing, and it's on at GDC, at the Firefox booth at GDC. And if you take out your phones or your laptops now and visit this URL, if you can, and you have a WebGL-enabled device,
which is everything.
This may well take down our server.
Take down the server.
Yeah, let's go. Yeah. Sorry. It's tanks, T-A-N-X, .playcanvas.com. Multiplayer tank battle. We've got 4 or 5 people in. And so this is really for us demonstrating just seriously how easy is it to get... How easy is it to get into a game? This runs in, you click a link in Facebook, this opens the game. You click a link in Twitter, this opens the game. You IM this, you know, you send this in WhatsApp to your mate, he clicks a link, it opens the game. This is like the ultimate in kind of casual social gaming, that you can get this stuff, and it's not just 2D canvas stuff anymore. It's WebGL, and it's amazing. So, that is it. Thank you very much. One last thing, we have a competition this month. If you go to Play Canvas and you make a game for our Play Hack, so we give you a project to start with, it comes with a buggy asset, fork that project, make a game, and the best one wins a Chromebook 2.
Nice.
So, you have till the end of the month to do it. And come say hi if you're at GDC. We're on the ARM booth, Expo 1624. And there is a talk tomorrow about the making of CMOR at the ARM booth. I can't remember what time it is. And that's it. Thank you.
Cool, man. Got time for a few questions for David.
So back to your editor that you have.
Yes. What is the interim data format for 3D models in Play Canvas? Yes, so we have a JSON file format which we use to render stuff. So we
you can save it
off and load it back in. So we do it, currently we do it all server side. So if you upload an FBX or an OBJ or any of the file formats, we crunch it to JSON and then it sits on the server. But yeah, you can get that JSON file down again. Yeah. Yes.
Did you have any problems with the portability of your shaders? And if so, do you have any feedback for the WebGL group about making the spec more stringent?
So the one, So the two problems I can remember, and Will might be able to give some more detail, is one was the difference. Some platforms handle uninitialized data differently. So we had a lot of problems where our graphics program was working on Windows and it would all look great, and then he'd send it over to us and it wouldn't load on a Mac or on iOS because something hadn't been initialized and was initialized to 000 on Windows but not on Mac. So that was one issue. The other thing was a Chrome bug, unfortunately, on Mali, particularly Mali both processors.
Yeah, that wasn't about Chrome.
No. So float. The Chrome on Mali reports that it can do float texture extension, but it can't. So it says yes, and then you try it, and it breaks, which is annoying. And that is the reason we don't have any particles in that demo, unfortunately. But those are the only two problems I know of, but best talk to Will afterwards, because he can probably be better about that. Maybe.
More questions?
Yeah, who the hell is 2677?
Yeah, feature coming soon, you will be able to add your own name. Yes?
Are you differentiating the contents of, if you have a platform, somebody has a platform with, I don't know, a
SDC support? Are you going to be sending a different?
Sorry, yes. I think the question was, do we support different asset formats sort of at runtime? Do we get different? So this is part of the reason that this demo is quite large at the moment is because it actually downloads some of the textures twice, once as PNGs and once as ETCs. The idea would be, as this gets rolled back into the engine, that yes, it will say what type of texture do I want and what is available, and it will pick just the right one. So that is the plan. I mean, we need to do that for audio. We need to do it for textures, basically. So yes. One thing I didn't actually mention during the talk was, because we were talking about code size and stuff earlier on, the Play Canvas engine is 500 kilobytes. So. One more question? Yes.
You showed that the editor has like multi-editor capability, but how does the coding work? Like, do you have like Google Docs coded as well?
We don't right now. We have two kind of ways of doing coding. We have an IDE based on the ACE editor, which is a really cool text editor. The question was how does coding work basically in the development environment. So we have two systems. One is you code right into the browser, we save it on the server, and that works. It's very easy to get up and running. It works for up to a certain scale of project usually, and then at some point you want something a bit more secure. You're used to using Git and Mercurial and what have you. And so we also have a way of running with local code, or we have a way of syncing with Bitbucket or external source repositories, so you can check stuff in there and then just sync it onto our server. So that's basically how it works.
Okay, thank you so much, David. Play Canvas. Thanks everyone for being so patient and sitting through the presentations and being polite. We have about 40 minutes wherein we snack, drink, can talk to all the presenters, go get some demos of Leap Motion. Many thanks to all of our speakers. Can we have one more round of applause? And many thanks to Leap Motion for demoing and helping support our cause. Can we get a round of applause for Leap? And a special thanks to the Khronos Group, our eternal sponsors for the WebGL meetups, and Angela and Kathleen and Khronos for hosting tonight. This is a wonderful venue and a green space for having us. Okay, folks, have fun. We'll see you at GDC.